defer our application until the planned May meeting. During the in-between months, we met with each one of the committee delegates, providing them with the background that I've just mentioned. That's why I took the time to share it with you. And everyone agreed to the importance of our work and its relevance to them. But they were hesitant to offer their support, quoting questions posed by the Palestinians. A few of the questions we were requested to answer were as follows. On the Jewish National Fund's website, your organization states, to a large extent, the lands bought and redeemed by JNF over the years determined the borders of the State of Israel. Who was the land redeemed from? What is the border of Israel to JNF? What is, according to your organization, the legal status of the lands occupied by Israel in 1967, including East Jerusalem? Does the JNF acknowledge and adhere to the international law or Zionist ideology? What is the legal status of the Golan Heights for JNF? World, although we had already done that. Does the JNF of America participate in political issues in Israel and the occupied territories? It was obvious the direction they were going. Although our application had addressed many of these questions in great detail, and the more we responded, the more questions were posed. It was obvious to the most unbiased observer that the political question showed the true objective of the Palestinian and Syrian observers. Their aim was to use this ECOSOC forum as another of their ubiquitous efforts to demonize Israel. They refused to recognize Israel's right to exist. In private discussions with the Palestinian, there was agreement on the legitimacy of our work, which really amazed me, and the potential for assistance to their people. But the fact we were JNF and there was a JNF in Israel meant that we were part of the same and they had to fight us. At one point, we were even asked in private, why don't you change your name? In our quest, we systematically approached some of the members of the House of Representatives and the Senate and requested that they support our efforts by communicating their concern to the UN ambassadors of the voting countries. After all, we provide an enormous amount of aid to these countries. A letter was circulated among House members, and a second letter was circulated among Senate members. In a matter of days, 43 members of the House and 14 senators, including three presidential candidates, signed the letters that were faxed and mailed to each of the 19 ambassadors of the voting countries. As the Chinese expression goes, "Gut nicht helfen." From these questions, it was evident that our strong efforts resulted in increased intense lobbying by the Palestinian and Syrian observers. Now, at the last meeting in May, many delegates requested that we once again defer our application. In other words, keep deferring, deferring, deferring. Why don't you wait until next year? We made a decision. We wanted them to be polled. We wanted them to stand up and show, are they more interested in their people and how we could help, or was this just to be politics? Of interest is that on the final day of the vote, the ambassadors of Palestine and Syria came into the room. Their presence was there was an obvious reason for their presence. We were informed that we could request the overturn of the committee vote at the full NGO meeting in Geneva. The commitment to a very costly expense, together with the obvious omnipresent anti-Israel bias at any world UN gathering, resulted in our decision to defer. Instead, we will continue to provide our expertise to those decision makers who choose to place the improvement of their constituents' lives above political gain. In closing, I would like to quote from an article that appeared in the New York Sun reporting on our defeat in the UN. I quote, "It is praiseworthy to challenge anti-Israel bias at the United Nations on a case-by-case basis. The most far-sighted thinkers on this front are beginning to go beyond that to the next logical step. They have started to question whether an institution such as the United Nations, full of undemocratic countries and infected with the anti-Israel animus is the best forum to deal with global problems. And they are beginning to look as an alternative to a community of democracies. To this, I personally add, it continues to amaze that there are so many that continue to bite the hand that potentially feeds them. Thank you.